Okay.
3, 2, 1, sync.
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 There we go.
Sync.
That works. What are you doing?
Sync. Sync! What's going on? What is this?
We're going to talk about Overwatch.
Why are we going to talk about Overwatch?
Because we want to talk about it.
Says who? Was this your idea? Know. Is this why there's a microphone? Okay, hold on a second. All right. So we're going to talk about Overwatch.
Yeah.
And what are we going to talk about when it comes to Overwatch?
What we like about Overwatch and what we don't like about Overwatch.
What if I just don't like anything about Overwatch?
That's because you hate video games.
That's not true. That's not completely true. I like Gravity Rush, which is unfortunately anime.
You hate 99% of video games and like one video games.
I like Vanquish too, and Babe for the PS2.
I forgot you bought. You actually bought that, didn't you?
Yes,
as well?
I did buy Babe for the PS2.
Me a picture of it.
We were going to include that. So Overwatch, I hear that's a hot new relevant game.
Uh huh.
What?
All play of the game memes and that stuff.
That game.
High noon.
That game.
Dad
is just,
76.
The memes are strong with this game, which is, you know.
The memes are very strong.
I even seen Alex Navarro changed his name to Diva Blast, so you know that the memes are in full effect. Okay. Are we gonna start with the good things or the bad, or like what we don't like about Overwatch? Because there's like plenty to talk about what we do like, but should we go from maybe like worst stuff and then kind of make it a sandwich of things we like and then things we don't like, then something we like and something we don't like?
Why don't you lead off?
You would leave me to lead off, wouldn't you? That's just you.
Yeah. God. Lead the way, Eoin. Lead the way.
Okay, so I really like Overwatch's system in that, like, everything is just a rock, paper, scissors. I really like the idea of there's constant counters to everything, you know, and it forces you to switch up. Which is unfortunate because not everybody switches up all the time, but I do like.
Especially not when everybody just wants to play Reaper.
Yeah, like it's
Widowmaker.
It's like I want to be Junkrat. Well, everybody wants to be Junkrat, and it's like not everyone can do that. So it's kind of like when you're in pub games, that stuff can fall apart. But when you're with a full team, and we've played with a full team, we have a full team of like regular people who will constantly be on to play.
We have friends.
Luke has friends, I have acquaintances that I play video games with.
That's because everyone hates you.
Yeah, well, you know what? You're not supposed to like me. That's just how this is.
Are you one of those Marmite kind of guys? You're honest with your opinions, so you'll either love me or hate me. Is that you?
No. I'm not what some people like to call themselves as the lovable asshole. I'm not one of those people. My voice keeps cracking, god damn it. I'll be back in a sec. My voice keeps cracking, so I'm gonna have that happen a lot.
Yeah, are you finally going through puberty? Is
yeah, ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. So funny. Fuck you.
So Overwatch, you were talking about how you have to constantly swap heroes because there is always a counter to everything.
Yeah, there's always a counter to everything, and like 90%, like, this falls into something that I don't like about it, which I'm going to leave for later, but like everything's choke points, you know, it's constant, like, figure out what is the right composition of team to push through this point. When you push through that point, you know, that worked, which the enemy team themselves, or if you're the defenders, are going to have to switch up. And I really like that. I really like that it's like this constantly changing battlefield, which is a really, really stupid way to put it, and it's totally a marketing way to put it, but that's totally what it is. And
like, you could be doing really well 1 second, then just like one hero change and that guy can just destroy you.
Yeah, it's like if you're a Pharah and suddenly somebody on the enemy team changes to a Widowmaker or a Soldier 76, it's like, well, you're it's not that you're gonna have a bad time, you just need to know
they're gonna make it a lot harder for you to do your stuff.
Yeah, pretty much. Like it's every counter to people isn't necessarily a hard, like there are hard counters, but it's more like, you know, if you're a Tracer and someone's a Roadhog, well, like if you're a good enough Tracer, you can overcome that person. It's just that if they get you with a hook, you're kind of done, you know, like you have to play smart at that point. And I really like that because it feels fresh in a lot of games. Like it's like the same way that MOBAs have this counter, and you know, and Overwatch has definitely taken some things from MOBAs. You know, there's the ults, there's stuff like that.
21 heroes, I want to say.
Yeah, there's like 21 heroes, which is like the big thing of, I really liked TF2. I thought TF2 Classic, at least, was amazing before they put in all those hats and weapons. And to see Overwatch come around, and it doesn't necessarily completely recreate that sense. I would say it more does a better job of just like, this. I could play this game for hours. And I think that it kind of, in a way, trumps TF2. And people are saying it's an unfair comparison. It's not. It's a class-based shooter.
It's not. They're class-based shooters, yeah.
It's a little different. It's not completely different. It's still comparable. And I think that Overwatch does a better job of recreating that kind of sense of feeling that, like, I can come back to this anytime and have a really fun experience. And TF2 didn't have that. TF2 lost that really quick for me when it started going in the direction of, like, the market and stuff like that. And I'm not saying that's bad before anyone comes in and is like, the weapons are all balanced. I'm like, that's not the point. That's not the point. Like, if I was somebody who played TF2 in 2008, I should be able to know how a demo man is going to fight. Like, I shouldn't come to this game and go, oh, the demo man's using some kind of new weapon. Why is he charging at me with a sword and shield? Like, that's stupid.
That never made any sense to me.
Yeah, like, it changes it. And I understand that's adding stuff, but, like, there's no matchmaking in TF2 for me to be able to set it to go, okay, I want to play TF2 Classic. I could be wrong on this. I haven't checked in a while. I haven't played it in about a year or a year and a half. But there was no playlist options to go, okay, I want to play this like TF2 used to play. Because call me crazy, I think that's just the better way that game played. Not to mention, games of TF2 can last from anywhere to, you know, 15 to 20 minutes. Overwatch is like 10 minutes long. Overwatch is 10 to 15 max. 15, yeah. And that is a long game. That is a long game that probably has went over its timer and is in constant overtime. But
yeah, overtime can really extend games.
Yeah, it absolutely can if both teams are good enough. And I really like that. It does that same thing of like Rocket League, where I come to it and I'm like, well, I can shoot this out and go do something else for a quick 5 to 10 minutes.
I loaded up Rocket League yesterday for like the first time in a few weeks. It's just like, the game is still exactly the same as I remember it.
Yeah, and you can still be good at it. You'll be a bit out of practice. I felt like I was a bit out of practice today in Overwatch, but I didn't necessarily think that like impacted my experience in any way other than like,
nah.
Oh fuck, I forgot that I used to be really good at like throwing Junkrat mines and stuff like that, and I'm not as good because it's been like a week since I played. And besides that, you know, there's not necessarily a huge skill ceiling if you're somebody who's already played enough of it to know how the ins and outs. What do you think yourself? What is it that you really like about it?
I like the range of heroes, like, just because you can never walk into a fight and know exactly what's going to happen. And like, I think each hero does have a decent mix. Like, there are some heroes that specifically hinge on certain things, like McCree is always flashbang, fanhammer.
Mm.
Whereas Tracer can be like a mix of like just constantly moving or just running, shoot up a bunch and then run out again really fast.
Yeah, it's a real like sense of...
But I like the element of surprise. You can never be 100% certain of what's going to happen or who's going to start dominating.
Yeah, because like that... It's like another part about the rock, paper, scissors that I really like is that though there are hard counters to all these things, you know, the character you pick isn't necessarily the one that you're stuck to in terms of, but like I could be a Tracer and jump behind everybody and then just play the harasser, and that's really enjoyable because it works, it distracts people are like, fuck, there's this Tracer here, I have to deal with this while everybody else is coming in through the front charge, like there's a Reinhardt with a McCree and a Hanzo behind him, like it's just that kind of level of stuff can be really disgusting when especially when you have a coordinated team, because again, yeah. Pub games, kind of, you're going to see in this footage at some points that there are just places where people are like, oh, useless team, and it's like, You don't get that, obviously, among a group of friends, because, like, everyone...
No, because we all just blame one individual, yeah. Usually.
And it's usually Luke's fault.
Someone's... Fuck off.
It's usually Luke's fault anyway, you just, you know... Play your class, stick to your lane, you know? Farm yeah. creep. It's just, you know, you can't even nail the basics of that.
But yeah, like, for the large part, I think most of the heroes are pretty balanced. There's only a couple of heroes that really get at me. But then, that's kind of to be expected. I think there's always going to be heroes that are a little out of sync. Mm. And there's going to be constant patches every month. But for the large part, other than two specific complaints, I think the heroes are pretty well balanced.
Yeah. But I want to say they're doing something to McCree soon, isn't it? I think they're reducing the damage.
I think they're trying to nerf his Fan the Hammer so it's not as devastating against tanks.
Yeah, that's what it sounded like. Which is fair. You know, I felt like... Personally, as somebody who doesn't play McCree a whole bunch, like, when I play him, I can be good. But, like, he's one of those...
He's one of the easier characters, I think.
He's not one of the first people I pick. Like, I pick Pharah. Pharah is, like, my main... It's, like, yeah, I wouldn't Pharah's say he's my main, because I feel like saying someone's my main in a game where you have to constantly switch heroes is kind of dumb. But, like, that is somebody that I will go to in the event that, like, okay, we need an offense character, who are we going to pick? Well, people tend to not be able to fuck with Pharah, because Pharah's jetpack and, like, her rockets are just disgusting because you can fire and forget. One sec.
Yeah.
How are you? Yeah. I'm back.
Okay.
Yeah, like, it's that thing of... I felt like McCree was fine with his Fan the Hammer. I think, like, there were
some... people felt it was a bit too much against tanks. You could do a bit too much to them.
But the thing is, like, I do feel like that's kind of fair, in a sense.
Yeah.
Like, how does Pharah take down a Reinhardt when he has his shield up? She has to get behind him. She has to subject herself to the fire of the people behind the shield so she can actually do some damage to Reinhardt. How does McCree do it? Well, McCree's really squishy, so his flashbang has to be very situational. It has to be specifically at the right time, so that they're like around a corner or something like that, so that way he can Fan the Hammer and then back up. I haven't played enough of McCree to really know how disgusting he can be against tanks, but like against Roadhog, he won't kill a Roadhog in one go. He's not like necessarily a tank killer. He's more of just a tank, like. I don't know. You can just riddle their armor with bullets, and that I think is fair. But at the same time, if it's enough of a complaint that they see to patch it, that's fair. You know, I wouldn't. Let me say this: Blizzard's been running this game for over a year in closed beta, so I'm sure they know what they're doing way more than I do.
That being said, is there any heroes in particular that annoy you? I know we share a specific one that really frustrates us.
It's May, isn't it?
Yeah, sure.
May is
cancer, according to half the community.
According to half the community, but, like, I do think that it's one of two things. She shouldn't have as much health, or her thing takes longer to free somebody.
I play May a lot, and I think the range is a bit questionable at times. I seem to get people with it from pretty far away.
Yeah.
What seems more than reasonable. But I don't think it's... I think people just hate the way she kills you.
Yeah.
The way you die to May is incredibly horrible, because you get locked in place and then you watch the face of pure evil look at you and fire a massive stick of ice into your face. It's just like, it's not necessarily so overpowered, it's just an absolutely awful way to die because you're so helpless if she traps you.
Mm-hmm. I do think... Who else?
I think Widowmaker's Assault Rifle is supposed to be getting a bit of a nerf, which I agree with, because I think that thing could be a bit too much at close range.
See, I feel like I feel like it maybe should have a wider spread, not a damage reduction.
It shouldn't be a viable thing. It should be more you are peppering them while you try to run away.
But yeah.
I've seen quite a few people who play very offensively with that Assault Rifle as Widowmaker.
Like, I think...
And that's what frustrates me with it.
I think she should be able to... Like, because that... I think the reason that thing's so strong is because... If a Tracer goes up against a Widowmaker, Tracer should be... Like, if Widowmaker gets... or notices that she's getting the drop on her, that Assault Rifle should be able to take down Tracer really quick. But the thing is that... I feel like it has too tight of a range. Like, it should almost have, like, Tracer's level of... Not necessarily the exact same as Tracer's range, but, like, you know the way you see people who think they could be snipers with Tracer because they're idiots and are shooting from across the map as Tracer instead of getting up right, like, real close like she should? I feel like that should be Widowmaker's thing, is that the assault rifle should only work at a close range, because that should be the only situation where you need to use the assault rifle. You should only have to use it when someone's up against
it. It shouldn't really be a viable thing. It's more like, oh, someone's coming to me, I'm just going to fire at them as I run away. I don't think it should be like, if they know someone's coming for them, they can be ready for it. It's like, no, you should be running away. Like, snipers should be incredibly easy for almost anybody to take down at close range.
I'm not 100% on board with that, because if that were the case, then Hanzo's fire rate should be reduced.
Oh, Hanzo. Hanzo is one of the ones I hate the most right now.
Yeah.
I think he has a lot of problems.
I mean,
we could both probably talk for hours about our hatred of his ult, but I think there's a lot of other problems with him.
Yeah, I mean, like, that ult's really easy to dodge. It was always one of the big points of contention during the beta, because we kind of didn't know how to counter it. And now when I hear that ult, the only time I'm really annoyed is when I'm coming out of spawn and I'm just insta-killed. And I'm just like, oh, great, I couldn't do anything. Fuck this game. That's honestly the level of rage that I get to about it, but
yeah,
you know, other than that, it's fine. I just think that if they are going to do that Widowmaker nerf, they should do something to another sniper, who is Hanzo in this case, and kind of just adjust his firing time, because you can fire it really quick and people.
I still think they need to increase like the drawing time on his bow.
Yeah.
And maybe like put a damage modifier in it so he can fire them really fast, but they don't do much damage.
Yeah.
Whereas if he takes longer to charge them up, yeah, it leaves them exposed a little longer, but it does more damage.
Yeah, and no, that's great. Right.
He can like draw it in a second and it does very high damage,
yeah,
even to the chest or something. And that just really frustrates me because it makes him hard to deal with at close range.
Yeah, like I've been killed by so many Hanzos up close, like who are panicking.
He's classed as a sniper in the game,
yeah,
so it's like he shouldn't be that effective at close range. I can understand medium range, I feel like he's supposed to be an alternative to Widowmaker, but he's still very effective at close range and it gets very annoying trying to counter him sometimes.
Yeah, I think, but other than that, like the game is really, really well balanced. It's got a great sense of like the, again, like the rock paper scissors thing, it works really well. It's the crux of the entire game, so to see that they've obviously spent so much time working on it that it's paid off. Mostly, you know, there's one or two inklings that we've kind of aired just there, but besides that, it's fine. It's great. Other than that, it's a really,
I'm
really good game.
I'm still a little unsure about Bastion. I still think it's not necessarily his damage. I just don't think he has a big enough accuracy penalty.
Yeah.
When he's firing, which makes him like he has insane range, and like I've seen many occasions like out, like just outdo snipers at long distance.
Yeah.
And I think that's really dumb. My other thought was maybe you should have like some sort of lowest sensitivity when he's in turret mode.
Yeah.
To stop people like him just immediately swinging around and killing anyone that flanks him to get to his weak spot.
Yeah, like he shouldn't be as well. It's not that I don't think
that
he should
maybe
be as
like
quick.
A limit. Apparently in the beta he had like a 180 degree limit, like he couldn't turn all the way around.
Yeah.
He could only turn like left and right.
I think.
Which.
I would say don't make it just 180 degrees, because I do feel like you should be able, as a Bastion, if you could defend yourself well enough, you should be able to turn all the way around, but your turning speed needs to be reduced.
Yeah.
Like, that would be a fair trade to that.
He has a weak spot on his back, but the second you poke the thing, he can immediately turn around and kill you.
Yeah.
Like, with, like, zero hesitation, and that kind of renders it mute unless you are like a Hanzo or something that can do like incredible amounts of damage with a single shot.
Yeah.
Like the amount of times I've got behind him is like a Soldier 76 and just tried to shoot the back of it only for him to immediately turn around and shoot me in the face. Just kind of, it's like, it's not worth the effort of trying to get behind him because there is no behind him. You can turn around immediately.
Yeah, the only person that's really, I would say the only people that are really good at that is a Junkrat, a Hanzo and a Pharah. Pharah is really disgusting against Bastion. That said, Bastion doesn't take a whole lot to get to Pharah in terms of like aiming, so she has that problem of if she zooms up in the air, Bastion can take her out really easily. At least Hanzo, well, it's more just like smart where you don't do that. You have to just peek around corners and fire and forget with Junkrat and the rest of them. Like, you can drop a Bastion awful quick with Junkrat.
Yeah, like, I don't hate him as much as I initially did. I realise there is a fair few counters. I think there is still inherently a problem with his accuracy when he's in turret mode.
Yeah.
And it's him and the other one, Roadhogger, they have self-heals. Mm-hmm. I think they self-heal way too fast.
Yeah.
Roadhog especially, I think, is disgusting to self-heal. Like, he can, unless you are someone with serious burst damage, if he gets a second to run off and heal, he will just come straight back in at full health.
Mm-hmm.
And he can, like, completely render, I guess, more, like, steady, focused damage dealers. He can just render them useless by just taking a step back and healing.
Yeah.
Like, it needs to be more in line with, like, the Sandwich and Team Fortress, in that it's big and it's obvious when he's doing it, and it leaves him exposed, but he can fully heal himself while he does it.
Mm-hmm.
Just, I feel like the fact that he can basically heal at least half of his health in a matter of a second is just a bit too much.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely fair. What else?
But, like, those niggling complaints aside, I like the rest of them. I think Hanzo is probably the most unbalanced, and the rest of them are just sort of minor things that kind of irk me.
So moving on anyway from the gameplay, there is one thing that I had actually heard somebody else bring up as a really good point that I thought would be worth sharing for the video, is that, like, you think about the amount of lore that this game has, and you think about, like, all the cinematics and everything, none of that's in the game.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like even just the bio of characters is something that I have to go to another website to see, and I feel like I should be able to see any of that stuff from the game. What's even more is that, because I know that they're doing all these comic books and all this kind of thing, I feel like we should be able to read the comic book from inside the game. But I know that they're going to be plugged on the Battle.net client, but if it's somebody on console, that's something, you know, I don't know if the animated shorts appear for people there. I haven't seen, I've only played on PC. But I do think that people should be able to see, oh hey, there's a new comic, and it just opens up like a little comic book reader. You can flick through the pages, you can zoom in and stuff like that, like the most basic level stuff. I think that stuff should be available in game, because like that was one of the biggest deterrents for me from getting into like all the comic books on TF2 and stuff like that. Like, I don't, like, you, did you ever get into that stuff? Like all the,
I read like some of them,
yeah, and I hear they're fantastic.
Not too much.
It's a thing of, if you can't get me to, or if there's no easy way for me to access it inside the game, I'm just not gonna go look for it. Like, it's like one of the things in Destiny, like one of the biggest complaints about Destiny was, hey, you unlocked this like piece of lore, go to Bungie.org to read it. It's like, no, yeah, dude, I should be able to read this from inside the game. Like, just
Doom
update
does that.
The game. Yeah, like,
Doom has an in-game codex. It just is filled with like unreal amounts of detail.
Yeah, and I just think that, I do think that, like, this game needs that, and it would really benefit from it. It would get me to come back, even not to play it, just to load the game up and read a comic and then fuck off. Or if there was, like, if I went into it, you know, I don't know if this exists, but I do feel like they should, if they're going to put these comic books out, if I can sign up to some kind of newsletter to just say, hey, the section of this comic is done. Do you want to download it as a PDF? Because then I just put it on my tablet and read that. Or, like, if it was a...
Yeah, they could definitely, or at least do more to promote it in the game itself other than just Battle.net ads, because I ignore Battle.net ads completely. Like, why they can't put, like, a loader inside of it. Even if it was, like, loading it off the internet, you don't have to actually download it.
Yeah.
Because Overwatch is online anyway, you need the internet to play most of it, if not all of it. So why they can't just put like an in-game streaming hub for it? Because they put so much effort into building this world.
Yeah.
And then not really putting any of it in the game itself is kind of a weird choice.
I would say the game also... Oh, one sec. Go back in a sec. I do think another thing that this game would benefit from is situational tutorials. Like, you think about that Soldier 76 tutorial that is in the game. It's really basic. It just says, like, okay, here's how to move, here's how to aim, here's how to shoot, here's how to use your secondary ability, and here's how to do an ult. And it's like, they kind of don't say, like, hey, you know, as, like, if they're going to go that basic, they should at least go, okay, here's how to play Hanzo, here's how to play Pharah, here's how to play somebody who plays completely different from 76. here's a...
'Cause 76 is the standard FPS guy.
Yeah, like...
He's supposed to be the entry level for anyone coming from, like, Call of Duty or something.
That's understandable, but I do think that they need to at least accommodate people. If they're going to go as low as saying, okay, this tutorial is so basic, somebody who's never played video games can play this. Somebody who's never played video games before is going to understand how to play 76, and no one else. They're going to have to learn how to play these other people, and they're going to have to learn by playing the game as opposed to a tutorial. Like, it's like, if you're going to go as far as being the most basic in trying to teach somebody who's never played video games how to play Overwatch, do it with every character. And I understand that 21 tutorials is a lot, but the game is also full price. On console, not on PC now. On PC you can get that for, like, I think it's...
It's full price and multiplayer only.
Yeah, it is multiplayer only, so you should go that extra length.
Considering it's how heavily driven around classes, the least they can do is give you a bit of training in each one.
Yeah.
Instead of just saying, this is how to do basic things that are specific to one character. Oh, you want to learn the rest of the characters? You'll have to do it in multiplayer while there are people who probably know what they're doing.
I mean, you can play against AI. Kind of,
yeah.
But, like, at the same time...
Yeah, having, like, a playground just to test that stuff. I know there is, like, a sort of empty, like, sandbox you can run around with and shoot stuff.
Yeah.
But, like, maybe more specific tutorials for each character would be helpful.
Like, situational stuff. Like, it's one of the things that... Another thing I had heard this from is a big Street Fighter fan. And they said, like, you know, Street Fighter V doesn't have any of this stuff. And this is another game where situational awareness can really pay off. So if the game was to teach you about these kind of situations, that would help people who are, like, not necessarily lower skill, but, like, lower level. So, like, for example, you got Tracer's Bomb. It's like, well, what's Tracer's Bomb good for? Well, you can use it to stick to somebody, or you can stick it in an area, like, a tight area with where there's a lot of enemies. There should be, like, mini scenarios where it's just like, okay, here's how to play Tracer. Okay, here's, you know her zip ability, you know her recall ability to get out of somewhere with damage. Here's an area where there's a bunch of enemies in a really tight space, like, huddled around a Reinhardt with a shield. Stick the Reinhardt and then recall. It's like, couple that stuff, and then that teaches you, okay, I can run in, plant the bomb, recall, zip out, and then watch everybody die. And it's like, there you go, that's a scenario that you would pick up on by playing a lot of the game, but if you're somebody who just doesn't have the time to put into it like the rest of us, that should be something that can still be taught to you.
Yeah.
Like, I do think that should be
there. By the game itself, yeah. Not, like, reading, like, on it.
And people will say, you know, that's hand-holdy. Yeah, it is. Because Overwatch is a game that, like, it's not that it holds your hand. It's just that it's a game
it
that...
It doesn't really give you anything to begin with.
Well, it's...
Other than a brief, very brief tutorial.
It's not even that.
The basics.
I think it's that, like, the game says... Or it's not that, it's that they're pitching this as a game that anyone can play. So if it's a game that anyone can play and they teach you the most basic stuff in that tutorial, guess what? Just because those hooks are, like, that are there to teach you are something you're not going to use and you think is kind of dead weight, is going to be something that, you know, my dad could get into. My dad doesn't play a lot of class-based FPSs. He doesn't play any. He doesn't play multiplayer games. But that's something that he could benefit from, and I guarantee you if it was there, he would probably actually give it a shot.
Mm.
But
that kind of hinges into something me and you both talked about, in that we feel this game is lacking content in general for being a multiplayer-only game.
Yeah, you know, I think that the game has a lot of depth, it has a lot of characters, and, you know, I'm not saying I think that... When people counter this by going, well, you know, League of Legends only has, like, one or two maps, that's not my point. You know, that's a MOBA, so there's hundreds of characters to go from. I think that with Overwatch, while there's 21 characters and they all have completely different playstyles, 90% of the maps are just choke points. And I get that, and I get that's kind of the point, but there should just be maybe one or two maps or one or two game modes that just aren't a payload. That aren't a King of the Hill, that aren't, you know, there aren't choke points. I think that there could be something there. Obviously, me, not playing armchair game designer, I'm not going, you know, I would put this in, I think this is a good idea. I'm just saying that, like, I do think for the price of 60 on consoles, now it's 40 euro in the EU store, and I think that's absolutely a fair price I paid for. I do think there should be maybe one or two more ideas. And obviously they have the Tavern Brawl stuff from Hearthstone in this, and I hear that's really good. But that's not the kind of stuff I'm talking about. obviously this goes back to us talking about the lack of tutorials. Maybe even a story sequence would be really cool to teach people or give somebody some kind of experience outside of the, I think it's what, like 6-8 maps? I can't remember off the top of my head, but like outside of those maps.
There's not many.
Something else. Something else that would have been a really a neat idea to add onto it. But that would be it. That would be my biggest problems with Overwatch. I think that would be where it kind of ends. You know, I think it's a really immensely solid game that has these minor problems on that side of, like, if you don't have friends, it's not really recommendable, because pub games are kind of a shit show. If you're playing on PC, it's a bit easier because you have text chat, so the barrier of voice chat isn't really there. And if you have friends to play with, it's really fun. But without friends and spending full price in this game, like if you were somebody buying this game for console, I would say don't buy it by yourself. Get somebody else to play with you, because at least that way you can just go, it was a shit game, but we tried our best, as opposed to the pub games when you're like, fucking, this guy's just playing Reaper and he's playing nothing else. There's no use for this. There's no reason for him to be here. He should be somebody else. You can't really convey that outside of voice chat on a console. And that's why text chat is nice on PC, because you can kind of go...
Yeah, like that game we played earlier where we got two with M8s and no tank. We were like, why? Because will you please play tank? Somebody swapped a tank. And we said thank you to him. Like, with the maps though, my complaint, I feel like a lot of them are just closed corridors. I don't feel like many have open spaces. And even those that have open spaces, I just feel like a lot of slightly bigger rooms together. Like, it's like, you have the corridor, so like, if you look at payload maps, it's always, there's the path the payload's going, then there's a path to the right, and there's a path to the left. And maybe there's a building you can jump over sometimes. But I feel like that just kind of, it can be really limiting in places.
It does feel like it's a little limiting in scope sometimes, but I also understand that from at least, you know, my fucking armchair game design standpoint of going, well, you also don't want people going off the beaten path and going somewhere where it's not completely useless. Like going in, like it's like, oh, there's like 7 different hallways. Okay, I'm gonna go take the left one. Oh, it's a dead end. You have to go take the other corridors. And it's like,
yeah, I'm not necessarily saying I want more corridors. I'm just saying I'd like more open areas. I feel like most of them are just corridors. So like someone like Junkrat already has an advantage because they just fire and forget down the thing anyway.
Yeah.
As opposed to, there's like a couple of spots that I'm trying to think which ones I like. I like, I think it's Nepal, the capture zone that's on the inside of a temple. That's like a really open area, and that's one of my favourites, because that means you, like, it's hard to defend and attack, because you can attack or get attacked from anywhere.
Yeah, and it all depends on the whereas like other ones, enemy team take.
Like, I think in that same map there's another one that's like inside a building, and then there's just a door on the left and a door on the right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's way more stacked in the defender's favour, because if they have people in there, they know where they need to watch. Whereas on the previous example, they can come from anywhere. You won't know where they're going to shoot from. They can drop down and come from one side, or they can, like a sniper, can start shooting from a distance.
Yeah.
I just feel like most of the maps are just closed areas. Try not to get killed by the spam of explosives coming from a Junkrat or a Pharah. Like, once again, yeah, you can counter it with your classes, but I just feel like it's really limited. Sometimes, like, what you can actually do with certain characters is limited by how maps aren't very open in places.
Yeah, I agree with you. I just think it's like, sometimes it does feel like it doesn't matter what comp you have, there's just no way you're getting through theirs.
Mm.
And that can feel really annoying and really frustrating, and whether that's balance or player skill is kind of neither here nor there. It's kind of like you still feel like you can't come back against that.
Yeah, it's because once it gets to a point where they have to just watch, like, you've got 6 people just trying to cover 3 entryways that are all very closed off and thin. Like, the end of Hollywood is one that always kind of annoys me, because it's just like 3 to 4 specific doorways that they can come through.
Yeah.
So it's a lot easier to defend purely because you just need to keep an eye on it, and you'll know, and you can just immediately push them back or start shooting at them so they can't come through.
Mm-hmm.
Because on the other hand, I like how each map is like, the colour schemes are completely different. Like, you're just set in like a different country, so they always look visually different. Just, I feel like, design-wise, they are all very similar.
Yeah, no, it is.
And like, I know that when designing these maps, they have to try and accommodate each and every hero. But in the end, I still think it's lacking to only have 6 to 8 maps to be a only multiplayer game that's been in development like for years.
Yeah.
To only have like that fewer maps, I think is just not very good at all. I think that's a big problem.
So the loot box system? I know.
So, okay, so my other big complaint is the loot box system. I don't like that the only way you can get them right now is leveling up. I'm sure in the future they're going to change it. They'll bring in like a Hearthstone system maybe of completing challenges. Yeah. But I feel like that should already be in there.
No, absolutely. It is that thing of you play it and you're like, look, some people have the power to resist the microtransactions. I am not one of those people. I'm just not.
I am not either, and I hate myself for it.
I'm a weak
but
boy.
I think the system is a really shitty way of encouraging that, because you get them really quickly to begin with, but the more you play and the slower you level up, the slower you get them, and then you kind of... It's like a drug, basically. You have loads to begin with, but then the more you have, the more you play, the less you get it, and that kind of tips you, and you're like, oh, I'm going to have to pay money. Because I will say it till the day I die, fuck microtransactions in games. Mm. Like, anything that isn't free to play shouldn't have microtransactions at all. And yeah. I will not give Overwatch a pass for it, even though it's purely cosmetic. But I just don't like the system to begin with, let alone the way it kind of really will push you even further to buy microtransactions, considering there is currently no other way to unlock any of the cosmetics.
Yeah, like I think...
That you only get them through loot boxes. Which they give you duplicates, and considering how many sprays there are alone, you should not get duplicates. They really shouldn't. I just don't think that should happen at all.
Yeah, and they're like, oh, it gives you cash to build towards your next thing. It's like, I don't care. I understand that there are certain things that I want, but like, dropping me this cash so that I can feel good about myself or feel better about myself for getting this loot box that had multiple duplicates.
Says cash that also is only available through loot boxes at the moment.
Yeah.
Which kind of makes that currency useless until they introduce a way to get it outside of loot boxes.
Yeah, like, even if the challenge system was that. Even if the challenge system was, hey, you know, get complete challenges, like, complete these challenges and you'll get 25. You're like, 3 challenges a day and you get 25 coins or whatever for them. 25 Zenny, whatever fucking made-up currency they have in the game.
Yeah.
Like, even just that would work. Even that would feel better than, like, what it is. Because what it is kind of... It's purposefully shallow, and that's what... Like, that's the kind of incentives that Blizzard, I think, offer in Hearthstone as well. But there are just alternatives for people. There are other ways around it that are nice.
Mm.
That you just don't feel like you have... Or just feel like aren't existent
in you Overwatch. Only get them from leveling up or paying for them.
Yeah,
there's no
totally.
Other way to get them right now. And I just think it's a really horrible system, because it just drip feeds you it and then it'll make you want to buy them.
Yeah,
whereas I just staunchly oppose to microtransactions and retail games.
Yeah, one sec.
Right, then, tell me, what are your pros and cons? What are your best and worst for Overwatch then?
I think, so in summary, like, the things I really like about the game are, I think, multiplayer is mostly well-balanced. You can put that in all caps. I think that it's got a really great sense of style, a really great sense of character that a lot of other multiplayer games tend to kind of abandon, and people kind of build up these, like, memes and stuff like that. Overwatch is a game that has a whole lot of character that fans have only expanded upon, and that's something that I really like. I really like the fact that the game isn't full priced. Actually, don't include that one. I think that it's... Well, that's kind of it. I mean, I just think it's a really... I think it's a really fun game. I think that... The microtransactions and the lack of map variety is a bit strong, but like, the map variety is just such a, like, it's such a non-issue for me. It's just an observation more than a complaint that I would put in the cons. I think that, like, it's really stingy for loot boxes, and that would be about it for me. If I were to honestly give it a rating, I'd probably give it a 4 out of 5.
Okay. I guess I'm along the similar lines. I like the range of characters and that they have character. And like they're all like very diverse in terms of gender and nationality and such. It's pretty cool. I do like the map design, like in terms of themes and colours. Like everyone is a different country and they have a very strong style to them. But I think the loot box system is my biggest grievance with that game. And I feel like it's really shallow, poorly designed. Well, not poorly. I think it's intentionally designed to engineer you to buy more microtransactions. And it frustrates me to no end. But score-wise, I would give it a 3.5.
A 3.5? But Luke, you forgot my number one rule.
What's that?
We don't do half scores.
Don't we?
No.
Okay, fine, I'll give it a 4 then if we can't do half scores. I don't know, I'm in that awkward place because it's middle between them. No,
it is
fuck you,
it
I'm
is absolutely
saying
a 3 or 4.
3.5.
Fuck you, this is the... No, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
So. Yeah, but I give Overwatch a 3.5 and you give it a 4, right?
Done. Fuck you on your half scores.
Fuck you. Whatever. That's our thoughts and opinions on Overwatch. I would like to say I think Eoin is completely and utterly wrong in everything. Would you like to say anything, Eoin? No, Eoin would not like to say anything. So thank you for watching.
Fuck you!